Let's go.
Let's go.
Oh, no. Do you want to?
Sorry, sorry. I'll let you.
Next one. I'm excited and I feel relaxed and I'm ready to party. Don't say sorry. You don't need to do that. You don't need to apologize. It's a fucked up female habit. You don't need to be sorry for anything ever.
Can you guess what every woman's worst nightmare is?
I don't have rage issues!
I have nothing to prove to you.
When I'm good, I'm very good. But when I'm bad, I'm better.
I say when it comes to stardom and Lauren, there are no accidents.
Hi, Karen Peterson.
Hello, and welcome to Citizen Dame, the podcast where summer movie season is upon us. I'm Karen Peterson, joined as always by Lauren Humphreys-Brooks.
Hello.
How are you, Lauren?
I'm good.
Good.
Good. I think we have a good chat today. I am going to be interested to see what we come up with on this one.
Yeah, I'm really excited for this too. I've been looking forward to this one for a long time, actually. So it's here and it's time. But we did have a little bit of a break. So did you enjoy your week off?
I did. Yes. Had a little bit of a rest. Although New York has been like really unfair to me in weather-wise because the weeks have been gorgeous and then the weekends have been just like cold and rainy. And finally today, it's like, it's cooler, but it's like nice out. So I'm definitely like going to go do something this afternoon. But it was nice. I had a little bit of a break. Gave me a chance to watch the films that we're talking about this week, which I'm very excited about.
Yeah. So it's May and that for most people means summer movie season starts in May. And it's off to a little bit of a slow start, which is unfortunate because I'm going to tell you the Fall Guy is a lot of fun and it needs to be making more money. But that's neither here nor there. What we wanted to talk about, though, was blockbusters. And who better to kick off a conversation about blockbusters than to talk about Steven Spielberg, the guy who kind of made blockbusters a thing. Yes, there were blockbusters before Jaws, but nobody really talked about them that way until he came along. And
it was a shift. There was like Jaws kind of broke something and like things changed at that moment.
Yeah, it's really true. I mean, my parents remember going out to see Jaws, to see other movies in the 70s and early 80s and just lines wrapped around the block. I remember when I was before. Now it's great because you can just reserve your seat, but it kind of has changed something again where there's something different about not seeing people lined up outside of a movie theater waiting to go in and see something, you know. And that was Spielberg's early career is really what got that made that become a thing. You know, and honestly, I think really had a lot to do with driving ticket sales for a lot of movies at the time.
Oh yeah, so. Definitely. Well, I was not around for some of the really early blockbusters, but even like I remember going even as late as like the release of the re-release of the Star Wars films.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember like it was that sensation of it being an event. I think that the release of certain films became this thing, like, you know, you went really early to the theater, you stood in the line, there was like this energy and excitement that kind of circled around it. And that's changed, obviously, and it's changed in some ways. It's a good thing because there's greater access to films to a certain degree, but then it also has kind of removed that sensation of it being an event, and it's not something you can really recapture.
Right. Yeah, exactly. Because I mean, one of the things that I see now is when I go and okay, I'm going to because, you know, I have AMC A-list, I'll book my tickets ahead of time, sometimes way ahead of time. And I'll just like go on there. And if I see a screening has a lot of full seats, I'm like, well, I'm going to pick a different one because I don't like where the choices are, you know, instead of waiting in line and hoping to sneak into a good spot or whatever. So,
yeah, exactly. I think the last time I actually going to see Barbie with kind of a packed house where basically like I reserved seats for myself and my friend and I found like aisle seats and everything, but there's still a little bit of that sensation of it being an event of like, you know, everybody was wearing pink and you know, the girls were all talking in the bathroom line about how excited they were about seeing Barbie, you know, that kind of thing. And that was a similar kind of experience, but yeah, just that sort of breathlessness, I guess, that films in the 90s and the early aughts, and really until fairly recently, had that kind of sensation of like, ooh, this is really exciting, right?
Yeah. Do you remember the last movie you really waited in line for? I was trying to think. I can't remember.
Not like a first run film. I'm trying to remember. I mean, I remember there being kind of a big event emotion around the release of the Infinity War and Endgame. But I think when I went to see that, it was very like intense. But I think that when I went to see that, I was still already reserving seats. And so it was that sensation of like, you know, you're gonna get in, you know where you're gonna sit, which is nice, but also kind of remove some of that anxiousness and that intensity. Yeah, I don't remember last time I really
I'm
stood
trying
in
to,
line for a film.
yeah, I'm trying to think. It's got to have been one of the Harry Potter movies, maybe. I guess,
Yeah,
probably.
one of my strong actually one of my stronger memories is standing in line for, I think it would have been Force Awakens on opening weekend. And again, I don't know if that was the last one that I really stood in line for, but it was that same kind of like, you know, lines throughout the lobby, halfway out the door, you know, all of these people talking and like that kind of energy.
You know what?
And
Now,
that was at a
yeah.
point. Yeah, that was at a point we like definitely in the local theater that I was in, we could reserve seats at that point. So,
I think you might. Yeah, I think that might have been one of those for me because the theater that we went to also didn't have reserved seats. So it was like Force Awakens or one of the Jurassic World movies, maybe. Something like that. So I guess it was more recent than I remembered, but still, it's been a while.
Yeah, it just doesn't happen anymore.
Yeah, and
Like,
it does. It totally changes that experience. But let's talk about a couple of movies that definitely had people waiting in line. And a couple of these, I waited in line a long time. So today we're going to talk about Spielberg's first blockbuster, Jaws from 1975, and then I actually wanted to also look at what are his highest grossing movies, and I think some of this has to do with re-releases, but we're also going to talk about E.T. from 1982 and Jurassic Park from 1993. So that is our plan for today. So let's start off with Jaws. Like I said, this came out in 1975. It was based on the 1974 very popular novel by Peter Benchley and stars Roy Scheider. He plays a police chief who's new to he's from the big city, New York, and he's new to the small island of Amity, and suddenly finds himself with a shark problem and also a lot of political issues because of it. And he ends up eventually getting Richard Dreyfuss as a marine biologist from the institute to come out, and they hire a shark hunter to take them out and try to deal with the shark problem. So, Lauren, why don't you start us off with your general thoughts about Jaws, and then we can talk about why it's still a perfect movie after all these years.
every time I watch this movie, it does just give me this moment of like, this is filmmaking, you know. It's it, and it's such a just a solid film. I think that that's one of the things that Spielberg, when he is on, he is so good at. He understands story structure. He understands character. He knows on not just like in terms of, you know, plot or whatever, but on the screen, how to structure everything on the screen, how to use the visuals and the music, the dialogue, like everything. He just really builds it all so well, and it works. And Jaws is just like totally emblematic of that. It is so well made. It's one of the things I really like about it is that there is a lot of humor in it. Like, it could have been a much more serious, I guess, to a certain degree, more like darker film in a lot of ways, but there is enough of that humor. You get that those elements of like the shark is serial killer, which I fucking love. I love the fact that this is basically a giallo film for half the time, but the murderer is a shark. But it is, you get that same sensation, and some of it is that music cue, which is so influenced by Psycho. And the fact that you don't see the shark for most of the film, you sometimes see outlines, you see fins, you see movement in the water, but you don't actually see the animal itself, right? Until very, very close to the end. And all of that just works so well to kind of build the tension and the expectations of the audience and our relationships to the characters. It is just so incredibly well done and so entertaining. When I started watching it this time, I was like, oh, I'll watch like the first hour and then I'm gonna do something else. And I couldn't. I watched the whole film. Because it drives you along, it brings you along. There's not a lot of downtime. And but it also is not so relentless that you just can't handle it. It's just so incredibly well paced. And watching it is just so entertaining. And it really does work exactly the way that he wants it to. It's amazing.
Yeah, I don't remember the first time I saw Jaws, but I was probably way too young for it because I'm still to this day terrified of the ocean. If I cannot see the bottom, I am very afraid to go in the water. And that's all because of this movie. But yeah, I think that what he does with developing characters pretty quickly, developing characters that we're instantly, we care about them. We don't have to know, and this is one of the things that Spielberg has always been remarkably good at, is just putting us right into the shoes of people pretty quickly. So we know not just who to root for, but why. You know, we have a reason to care about them from pretty much the first scene. And that's what we get with Brody in this movie, is we're instantly on his side. We see him, we understand he's an outsider, and that has its own set of problems for him, as he's trying so hard to protect his home and his new neighbors, and they are resisting it so much, and everybody just kind of has their own. You know, you understand these small towns and these businesses, the idea of closing the beaches and ruining their summer business is devastating for them. But also he's just trying to protect them, keep them safe, and he just, yeah. And then the conversations that happen between him and the mayor, Larry Vaughn. It's one of those, it's so interesting. This is one of the things that I feel like is part of why Jaws has had such a long life. Not because it's really, not just because it's like a fun monster movie slash shark serial killer movie, which is a great point by the way. But also because of the fact that so much of it still to this day, almost 50 years later, feels so real and true to life, you know. You had said when you were watching it, you messaged me and said something about like that you just didn't like you wouldn't have believed that people would be so dumb in a crisis like this, and now we absolutely know that they would be.
It is very realistic, and you're kind of sitting there going like, there's literally a shark in the water. There is a shark that is eating people. Why are you not closing beaches? And the film addresses that too. Like, you've got the mother who's just like, how dare you? Like, you didn't tell us, right? But then you have this whole fight going on with the local merchants and kind of that pretending, like the point where they catch the smaller shark and they're like, oh, okay, it's all over. And the Richard Dreyfuss character, Hooper, I think, is,
Yeah, Hooper.
it's just like, that's not, it isn't the shark. It's not the shark. But that intensity of like, we want to believe that it is the shark, because that means that this is over and we can, we could go back to regular life. But it is that sensation of like, but it's not, we can't pretend that it is. But yeah, it's very believable, like you say, because this is an island that is dependent on their summer visitors. If you don't have the beaches open, you don't have any business. But then at the same time, you're like, yes, but people will be eaten.
It's such a tricky situation, and you get that, but at the same time, it's like there's a scene where right after they have caught the tiger shark, and everyone's just like, yay, it's over now. And Mayor Vaughn is giving an interview to a reporter, and he's like, oh yeah, we have caught a large predator that supposedly injured some bathers. He knows perfectly well that people died, and he's still not willing to admit it because he's a politician. And if he admits that, even while he's saying, oh yeah, we got the shark, he knows that that will still scare people away from coming out there. So he's not going to say anything to ruin, to ruin the tourism for his town. And it's like, it's understandable, but it's also terrifying that people are so so focused on economy that they would sacrifice that for safety. And
Sorry.
we saw that happen. We lived through a pandemic.
It is just one of those, like, again, watching Jaws now, you're just like, yep, definitely realistic. Don't want it to be realistic, but definitely realistic.
I saw a meme a couple years ago that said, we have to stop using the phrase avoid it like the plague because humans do not do that.
Well, and one of the things you get with Jaws, one of the things I like about Jaws is that there is gore, there is violence, but it's very well, I keep on saying well structured. He's very careful about how much he shows and how much he doesn't. So we get the blood in the water, we get the things that are destroyed, the really sad bit with the stick floating in the water, and the dog is gone, like, or the shredded floaty that the kid was on, things like that. So you don't get tons of gore, but there's just a little bit. But one of the most intense scenes in a certain sense is the scene where they finally, like, go to view the remains of Chrissy, I think her name is, from the very beginning of the film. And you do kind of like you do sort of want to go, like, at what point did you think that this was, oh no, this was someone who was caught in a boat propeller, right? Because we don't actually see the body, right? What's left of the body. We see like an arm, I think. But that's it. But the reactions of the characters to what they're looking at is so horrible that it is that sensation of, like, okay, something really bad happened. Like, and you get that kind of visceral nature, but without being subjected to, this mangled torso or body or head or whatever. So it's very, very effective. And it goes back to that, that element of the slasher film or the horror film where not showing certain things, not showing, so, to use the Psycho reference again, not actually showing the knife going into Janet Leigh, right, is almost more horrifying than seeing it, because you still have this stuff in your imagination. What does that body look like, right? What are they actually seeing? And you're getting the characters' reactions, but you don't actually see it. And so it's that wonderful element of cinema that if a director really understands what not to show, can make it even more terrifying and even more horrifying. And you're still sitting there going, like, well, nothing is actually bad, but it really is,
Well, and I think Spielberg, especially early Spielberg, was very adept at that too, because like we didn't talk about this movie, but Duel from just a year or two before Jaws, it was actually made for the TV. So it had necessarily had to be a little bit tamer. And that movie is terrifying. You never actually see the person that's coming after. You never see the truck driver. You see his feet at one point with his boots. You see a hand while he's shifting, but you never actually see him. And so it's like even from that point, you really see how he knows how to just, that's more terrifying than just seeing this trucker dude, and you see this with some of his other films too, where he's just very, he knows that it's all the gaps that we fill in with our own minds that are more scary than anything he could show us.
Yeah, exactly. It's very, as smart directors are able to do that, and you're able to craft the sensation of terror without actually showing anything that's really terrifying. It's that dependence on your audience, and also your belief that what you're communicating through the camera and through the audio cues, et cetera, and what your actors are communicating is effective enough that actually you don't need to show that. It would, in fact, probably if we saw some of the things, like we saw the truck driver in Duel, it wouldn't have the same impact, because by the end of Duel, it's almost like the truck is after him.
Right.
Like it's this, it's like not human. It's this other thing, that this like horrific otherworldly force almost.
Exactly.
And that is terrifying because it doesn't have any, there's no reasoning, there's no motivation. It just is. And it's a similar thing with Jaws, because you've literally got a shark that the motivation is, I'm going to eat you. Like that's the motivation for the shark.
Exactly.
And so you can't reason with that. You can't figure out its motives. You can't like, you know, be like, oh, what can we do to appease it? It's just like, no, it's going to eat until it runs out of food.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. All it does is eat and make other sharks.
Swim, eat, and make baby sharks.
Yeah. What I do wonder when it comes to Jaws though, is a big part of the reason that we rarely see the shark is because of the fact that they very famously had a lot of mechanical issues with the sharks that they created, one of whom is on display at the Academy Museum, by the way. It's very cool, and I've seen it, and it's gigantic, and yeah, it would be fucking terrifying to run into that thing in the ocean. But yeah, they had a lot of mechanical problems, and so it's interesting to imagine how much different this movie would have gone and how it might have actually turned out to be a lesser film if we'd gotten to see the shark more, if it had been working properly. And yeah, so it's almost like maybe Spielberg just got lucky with the problems that he had, and it helped turn him into a stronger filmmaker because of it.
Well, it's that kind of thing where you have to find a way to solve the problem, right? And you know, not to continue to reference back to Psycho, but Psycho, one of the things that Hitchcock couldn't do in Psycho, literally because of censorship, you could not show Janet Leigh naked. You could not actually show the knife going into her, because it would have been too lurid, basically. It would never have gotten past the censors. So he suggests it. And that's what happens in, it's suggested to the point that some people are absolutely convinced that they saw Janet Leigh naked in that film. And that's what Spielberg does in Jaws. He suggests the presence of the shark, the music cue, like the shadows, the rippling water, all of those things. And so the few times when you do actually see the shark, it's very impactful and it's quite terrifying, but it wouldn't be as powerful if we were just constantly seeing the shark throughout the film.
Right, exactly.
Problem. He may have solved a problem, right? Been like, okay, well, we're going to suggest the presence of the shark, but it's a fantastic way of doing it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And it's something that I think is one of the problems with a lot of movies today, is they can just CGI everything. If something's not working, they're just going to paint it in, or that's their go-to now. They don't do a lot of practical effects and practical, you know, monsters and things. Everything is computers. And so now you don't have to worry about things not working, mechanics breaking down. You just paint it in and it'll be fine. And so a lot of the inventiveness has kind of gone out of movie making, and that is such a shame.
Well, and it's something that I think creators and directors have to really think about now at this point, that you're not going to have that same kind of problem, right? So you have to actually be like, well, how does this actually work, right? You know, is it really effective to show the shark?
Exactly.
How effective is it to show the face of the killer? And I do think that the best films that manage that, like you do have a lot of filmmakers who are being very deliberate about it and are being very aware of how their story is functioning. Because we see that, and we see that in all of these films, that these iconic films that remain iconic in part because of that, right? It also shifts the focus onto the people. So we care about, so like we never, the, some of the, most of the shark's victims, we barely even know, right? We very briefly meet each of them. But Spielberg is so good at establishing their humanity immediately, and that horror of the loss, and how horrible it is, the, like this little boy who goes swimming becomes
Alex
this
Kintner.
Victim. Alex Kintner or Chrissy or the dog, right? That's he, it's structured so well because we see their humanity immediately and we're focused on their humanity more than we are on, ooh, the horrifying shark that we're going to enjoy watching kill people.
I did want to also just quickly mention, Jaws was nominated for 4 Academy Awards. And it won 3. I'm trying to pull up which ones, but I did not have that ready in time when I started talking about this. Anyway, one of the things that I find fun about Steven Spielberg is the fact that so many of his movies, like me being the Oscar nerd that I am, so many of his movies have been nominated for Academy Awards, and the first one was Jaws. And part of the reason I find this entertaining as a fact is that you even have like he became so popular that even movies like 1941, that everyone agrees is a terrible movie, gets nominated for 3 Academy Awards. So it's like he kind of just became this guy who was able to write his own checks and make whatever he wanted.
So the three Academy Awards that it was nominated for was Best Film Editing, Best Original Dramatic Score, and Best Sound.
Yes, it was also nominated for picture, but it didn't win picture, obviously. It won the
Oh,
other
okay, yeah.
three.
Lost
But
One
yes.
Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest.
Yeah, but Jaws nominated for Best Picture. So his first real feature film for the theaters was nominated for Best Picture. And we do still see that today. You see, debut feature makers get nominated for Best Picture, but then kind of what happens to them after that? Well, for Spielberg, what happened to him after that was Close Encounters of the Third Kind, which gets nominated for 9. So, and was a friggin' fantastic movie, but anyway, but before we get to that, just kind of final thoughts on Jaws. I just wanted to take a moment to say I really love when they do go out, the three men go out onto the water to go after this shark, and just the camaraderie and the male bonding that happens after some antagonism because of all the egos involved. I really love how that happened. I think it's just part of sort of the evolution of the story. It starts off, you got this guy, packed into an island with a whole bunch of people, and then by the end of the movie, there's only a couple of them left out in the middle of the ocean, getting back to shore. And just it's you compared this a little bit to Moby Dick as well, and I think that's such an apt comparison. And it just, it's sort of this quest movie, but it's really, the movie begins and ends with Brody, and he's just getting to see the full scope of his arc. I think is just it's such a satisfying movie and such a satisfying ending for him. So,
It really is, and I we can't, we're not talking only about Jaws the Satyr, but I really like the fact that the film is almost divided in half between the events on Amity and then the events on the boat. Like it's almost literally it's about a 2-hour film, and it's almost 1 hour for one and 1 hour for the other. And it's very well done, but I like the fact that this kind of serial killer film then shifts into this Moby Dick narrative with these three guys on a boat looking for the shark, trying to capture the shark. You got the old salt played by Robert Shaw so wonderfully. And then you get that those kind of male bonding moments where they're like showing off their scars and telling the stories and everything. Well, one of the interesting things about it is that there's a moment where Cooper and Quint are having this kind of, oh, this is, I got this from this and I got it. They're showing off like the things that have happened to them. And there's this moment where Brody like kind of lifts up his shirt and he's got a scar on his abdomen. And he doesn't say anything. He just puts his shirt back down. He doesn't speak to them. They don't even seem to notice it. But it is that like this wonderful character moment because one of the reasons we know that he left the city with his family is because he just felt like he couldn't make a difference in this jungle that was New York in the 1970s. And so you get the sensation of like, okay, he's been shot, he's been stabbed, something happened to him at some point, right? But he's not telling that story in the midst of this, whole narrative of these, this male bonding stuff, in which they're like, showing off the fact that they've gone through all of these different things. And so it's this really interesting character beat for him because he's still a little bit separate from the two of them. And still that kind of still waters run deep element to his characterization that I really like. And I think it's again, it's that moment where you're sort of pulling back on certain things and giving information about the characters without ever completely revealing everything about them.
Yeah, it's so true. Oh, such a good movie. And I just would
Such a good
also like
movie.
to point out he did not direct it, but Mayor Vaughn is still the mayor in Jaws 2. Local elections matter, people.
You kind of go like, how does this guy stay mayor? Like, does just no one else want to be mayor?
So true. But Brody is still the sheriff as well. So, until he gets fired in that movie.
I've not seen any of the Jaws sequels, I
Oh
admit.
man, so Jaws 3 is awful. It's like embarrassingly bad. Jaws 4 is also really bad, but there's something just really fun about that one. I think it's Michael Caine. I think Michael Caine is what's fun about that movie. But yeah, Jaws 2 is actually a pretty good sequel, even though Spielberg had nothing to do with directing that one. But none of it holds a candle to Jaws, obviously.
Yeah,
And
not
there's so
surprised.
many reasons why. Just like Quint's monologue when he tells the story of the Indianapolis, and it's chilling. It's absolutely not at all what happened to the Indianapolis. It's only sort of true. I mean, that incident happened, but not the way he describes it with the sharks. But the way that he tells that story is just it's that's an incredible. Incredible monologue that he gives and great job, Robert Shaw. So, but yeah, overall, it's just such a good movie and such a satisfying ending. It's a scary ending and it's just so good.
That's the other
And
thing. There's no coda. There's no like, now we're
right.
going to get them back onto the island and meet up with their families and everything is fine. It just ends with the two of them like paddling away. And like, you're like, okay, the shark is dead. They're okay. They're going to survive, right? But I like the fact that there isn't like this, let's wrap everything up at the end. It just ends on that. It ends on that, on the beach, them paddling back to shore.
And the credits roll as they are back on the beach, and that's it. But it's still just the two of them after what they've been through. So, yeah. Okay. Well, we're gonna move forward a couple of years to 1982 with E.T. the Extra-Terrestrial. This movie was nominated for 9 Academy Awards and won 4. And personally, I think this is John Williams's best score. I know that is a controversial opinion, but I stand by it. And E.T. is, I don't even know what to say about E.T. It's about kids finding an alien and one boy in particular becoming very close and bonded with this alien who needs to go home. And I know I saw this movie in 1982. I didn't really I remember seeing it, but I didn't really remember the details of it. In 1986, it was re-released. And my dad took me and my brother, and we were sitting in the mall waiting to go into the movie, and we're talking, and my dad starts telling this story about when he and my mom had gone the first time with a couple of friends, in 82. They were coming out of the movie and just messing with people in the audience. My dad's not very nice sometimes. They're messing with people who are not in the audience, who are in line for the next showing. And they're like, oh man, it's so sad when E.T. dies at the end. And my dad's telling me this story, thinking it's so funny. And I just was like, E.T. dies? My
Oh
dad is just like, don't you remember the movie? And I said, I don't remember that he died. And my dad's like, it's okay, it's okay. You're gonna be fine. You're just gonna watch it again. It'll be fine. And I said, I don't want to watch it if he dies. So he kind of had to tell me how the movie ends all over again because I did not remember because I was only a tiny, tiny child. But yeah.
Well, because the E.T. dying is like seared into your brain when you're a small child. If you've seen E.T. as a child, that is like, I know that E.T. does not die in E.T. I know that, right? And
And yet.
I remember seeing that movie when I was fairly, I was not alive when it came out. I was born in 1986 when it was released. So I was a child. Like I remember my parents showing it to me. And my most strongest, most vivid memory is E.T. dying, right? And so if you were to ask me when I was six or whatever, whenever I saw it, does E.T. die? Yes, he died. It's horrible. But of course he doesn't. Like he survives. He goes home. It's good. Everything is all right with E.T. But that's like the part that gets seared into your brain.
Except for I didn't remember that 4 years later because I'd only been five the first time I saw it. So, so let's talk a little bit about E.T. and why it's still such a wonderful, wonderful movie. Like I said, this is definitely my favorite John Williams score, but also this is one of my very favorite Spielberg films. And it's interesting because it's interesting how much I don't remember about seeing it the first time, but the second time, the 1986 release, is seared into my memory because this is, the family at the heart of E.T. is a divorced family. You've got a mom who's recently divorced. Dad is off in Mexico with his new girlfriend or whatever. And she's got three kids, one in high school, and then she's got Elliot, who's, I don't know, like 9, 10, something like that, maybe a little older. And then Gertie, her youngest, who's freaking adorable, Drew Barrymore. But she's dealing with all the mom is dealing with all of the emotions and the struggle of, being a single mom. And then the kids are dealing with the loss of their dad being out of the picture. And that is exactly what was happening in my life in 1986. My parents had split up. Their divorce was final in that year. And it was just me and my brother. And at the time, we were still seeing my dad fairly often, but he wasn't around. He didn't live with us. He had moved 2 hours away. So we only saw him for our every other weekend thing. So for me, getting to see this as a 9-year-old and really feeling like it's the first movie I can remember that reflected my experience of my life on screen. There were a lot of movies that were coming about of divorced families and stuff, but not really geared toward kids. And so it felt very much like I really felt like I understand, especially Elliot and Gertie. I really felt like I was kind of living a similar life to them. And so that is part of like that, those kinds of experiences really do stick with you. And that's part of why E.T., I think, to this day means so much to me.
That's interesting. Yeah, because it's one of those films that's very much about the kids all taking care of each other as well. Like, and the mother, what I like is that it's not like the mother's neglectful or is ignoring them or anything like that. She's a single mom who is also going through her own shit because her husband has, if it's fairly recent that they've separated, right? And so she's still having her own things, but she's got three kids that she has to kind of look after. So it is sort of this like, okay, the big one looks after the second big one who looks after the littlest one, right? And she's having to balance that while working and while like, trying to keep all of them alive and all of those things. And it's really well done, but it means that, the kids, so much is focused on the kids and how they kind of get together to take care of this little alien that really needs their help, and that really needs to be cared for. And they all of them, Elliot develops the most intense connection with E.T., but all of them develop this strong relationship with this little alien. And it is sort of implied that some of that is part of it is also healing for them in terms of the loss of their father, in terms of kind of the separation that they feel among each other. And kind of getting to come together to look after this alien and help him go home, is just like it's this healing element, I guess, that runs throughout the entire film, like letting things grow again.
Yeah, I think this movie is also a really good example of something that Spielberg is very, very good at, and that is working with child actors. You
Yeah.
see this with some of his other films. Like there's kids in Jaws and they're pretty good, and then also you see that with Close Encounters, but E.T. is it, I mean, it's entirely, a movie about these kids. They are at the center of the film, and the performances that he draws from them and the way that he is able to, first of all, I mean, it's great casting. Robert McNaughton plays the oldest brother, Michael. Drew Barrymore is Gertie, and then Henry Thomas is Elliot. And child actors, it's such a precarious thing. And to get a cast of kids that are really good, that don't become annoying. And not the characters, but like the actors, even with a good character, can sometimes become just annoying. And these kids aren't. They're just exceptionally good. And the performances from all three of them, especially from Henry Thomas and Drew Barrymore, are just phenomenal performances. And that is the mark of a director who really understands how to work with children.
Yeah.
And I think all of that is part of why this movie works so well.
Yeah, it treats them, and it treats the child's perspective in a really serious way. Like it's not, there is never that sense of, and this is true for most of Spielberg's films that involve children, that there's never that sense of talking down to them. The film is not condescending to them in any way. It isn't like, oh, these kids who don't understand the reality of the adult world. It's like these kids understand better than anybody else. And he places the audience, who are going to be a mix of adults and children, right? But he places the audience in their perspectives and makes them understand that the kids are right the entire time. The kids are right. The whole thing is very simple, but is made complicated by the adults around them, that E.T. needs to go home. We need to find a way to get him home. How are we going to get him home, right? And then the adults don't get it, right? They're horrified by this alien. They're terrified of him. They want to study him. They want to dissect him. They want to, like, and the entire time as the audience, you're going like, no, this is what needs to, we know what needs to happen. So you get that sensation of the frustration of the children and the fear, and also the fact that they know the answer, right? And the adults don't. And it's finally when the adults are like, basically half are forced more or less to listen to them because the kids steal ET and to get him home. And the adults finally kind of stop and listen, and that's when we get this, the catharsis and the solution to everything, and ET gets to go home. But yeah, it's so well done, the way that it takes the children's perspective and very much keeps you in the children's perspective the entire time.
Oh, sorry.
No, go on.
Well, I also wanted to just quickly recognize Melissa Matheson, who I believe has since passed away, but she was the screenwriter. Yeah, she died in 2015, but she was the screenwriter. She wrote the script for this. And between her script and Spielberg's direction with the film, I think it also really captures this understanding of children. Obviously, these kids, they have this alien. They know mom's gonna call somebody if she knows that the ET is there. But also, there's things that they try to do just that are really just about protecting mom, protecting her feelings. Early on, there's a conversation when Elliot has seen something, but he doesn't know what it is. And they're sitting around the dinner table, and she says, "Well, why don't you call your father?" And Elliot says, "Oh, I can't. He's in Mexico." And mom gets immediately like, just there's a cloud over her, and Michael is mad at Elliot, like, why'd you bring that up? You know she's really sensitive about it. And so there's also this need to protect mom emotionally, not just we don't want her to send ET away, but also it's like, and that's something that's very real that kids bring on, is this feeling. It's not necessarily like, it's not kids' responsibility to take care of the adults around them, but they feel like it is. And it really captures that so beautifully too, and really adds to just this beautiful, like in some ways heartbreaking, but also heartwarming story about this family.
Yeah, it's the care that the family has for each other. And they could have made mom into sort of more of an enemy almost, but she's never an enemy.
No.
She's not going to understand everything, so they understand that they need to conceal this alien from her. And her reaction is pretty natural. I do have to say one of my favorite scenes is where they're like putting away groceries, I think. And E.T. is like waddling around in the background,
He's drunk.
and she just like does not notice. I just like, there's an alien walking around your house, lady. Like, if you just miss, you're missing the alien.
And Gertie's
It's
trying to
been
talk to her and tell her too. She's like, oh, he's, I don't remember what
man
she
from
says, but
the
yeah, the man from the moon. And mom is just like, she's just come home from work. She's got groceries to put away. And she's just like, yeah, whatever. Okay. Just not
Yeah.
listening at all.
It's very smart. But yeah, but she's never typed as being their enemy or as being
Never.
someone. They conceal things from her because, you know, they kind of know how she's going to react to them. But even then, it's not this like bad reaction. It's like, that's a pretty natural reaction if you were to suddenly see an alien in your house. Like, I would freak out too.
Yeah. Especially by the time she sees him, he's dying and
Yeah.
he looks terrible. He looks terrible and terrifying. Like, of course she's gonna be. We need to get out of the house. But then there's a really great moment where it becomes very scary, where the government shows up and they just start invading the house. And it's like, okay, that can't happen that way, but it's really scary when
Well,
men that look like spacemen just show up.
and again, it goes back to that childhood perspective, right?
Yeah.
Because if something like that does happen, it's like, okay, no, you're not allowed to do that. But also that perception of scary things happening, the big adults showing up,
Right.
who don't understand, you know, they have these masks on, they have their, you know, their faces are concealed, all of that. And the film does that right from the very beginning as well, because we don't see their faces. They are these shadowy figures that are there to threaten the family, that are there to threaten ET. And they wind up being more complicated than that ultimately, but it feeds into that sensation of like, this is the perspective of a child. Of like, you know, you are trying to stop me from doing something that I need to do. And that terror of like, you know, all of these people showing up at my house
Right.
to take away my friend, right? To take away this creature that they don't understand and that I do.
Right.
Uh, it's very, it's again very well done. And again, that, you know, that element that we were talking about with Jaws of not of showing things correctly, right? No, so we don't see their faces for most of the film, really not until the very, very, like fairly close to the end, the final act. And even then, it's all of this terrifying stuff. It's all this medical equipment and, you know, half masks and things like that, where it's like, okay, this is not how to fix what's wrong with this alien.
Right. Yeah. And there's some things that watching it now are just kind of funny. Like when they come in, he has DNA. It's like, well, of course he has DNA. He's alive. But in 1982, that wasn't just, we understand things a lot better now, but yeah, I think, yeah, if you imagine this story being told years later when Gertie and Elliot are adults. And the way that they're going to describe when the government showed up is going to be very much how we see it in the movie.
Yeah,
It's,
exactly. It's continuing to keep that the audience in the child's perspective. And that's honestly why, like, you know, E.T. dies and I begin crying. And like that whole scene with Elliot talking to, they think he's dead, right? And I'm like, God damn it, Spielberg. God damn
Oh my gosh.
it.
And that's another example of just Spielberg working with kids and Henry Thomas also being a really talented young actor. That scene before Elliot does come back and they, or I mean, E.T. does come back and Elliot realizes this and is like, oh, we need to get him out. But when he's saying goodbye, like for real, he thinks really saying goodbye.
Yeah.
It's a heartbreaking moment. And he is so believable in that scene. And it's like, then he's crying and it's, oh my gosh. I can't get through that movie without crying. I just cannot.
Yeah.
And it's just really remarkable.
Well, and it's that balance of emotion. It never goes overboard.
Right.
It's emotional, and it's, you know, and like when ET leaves, you get this very simple but very moving dialogue between the two of them, right? And you know, and because that relationship has been built throughout the entire film, you know, you're so just like at these very simple lines of, you know, I'm like sobbing during the whole thing. But it's because there's like this understanding of very carefully choosing the emotional beats and very carefully choosing how the emotions are represented. So, you know, Elliot is not just breaking down in tears, screaming and crying and pounding the floor or anything like that. It's very real. It's much simpler and much more, and like he's trying to control himself in
Yeah,
places.
right. But then when he does realize ET is alive and he realizes he needs to make a distraction, so then that is exactly how he reacts, and you know, because he knows that that's what the adults expect, how the adults expect him to be upset about ET. And so he's, you know, it's really, it's so smart and so well done. And also ET is hilarious in that moment where it's like, you this is the time you need to shut up, and he's like, phone home, phone home, phone home. You just won't stop.
Like, shut up.
Yeah, but the movie does that. It has so many scenes that will be like moving or you know, kind of just introspective or whatever, and then it'll just do something really funny, and it always feels balanced. It never feels like a big sudden swing to the other direction. It just it's it really ebbs and flows so beautifully, and yeah, and it leads to this scene at the end, you know, when ET is people, his alien friends have come to get him, and he gets to go home. And it's sad because you want Elliot and ET to be able to stay together, but you also know that ET can't stay. If he does, he's going to die. And yeah, and then just that beautiful, beautiful score at the end. Oh, love it so much.
And again, no coda, no
No.
like, and now everybody goes home and we're gonna, or you know, ET comes back to visit or anything like that. Just that's the end of the film.
And I am so glad that there has never been a sequel.
Yeah, no, we couldn't have a sequel to this
It's
film.
a
It needs to just be what it is.
exactly. It's a perfect movie the way that it is, and it ends so beautifully. And we don't need to know anything more. We don't need to see ET come back, you know, some years later. We don't need to see what happened to Michael and Elliot and Gertie when they grew up. We don't need that. It's perfect exactly the way it is, and I'm very, very glad that they never made more.
Yes, same.
Any other thoughts?
No, it's a great film. I have not seen this one in a long time. I think probably at least 20 years, to be honest. But yeah, it was wonderful to watch again.
Yeah. ET was, like I mentioned, nominated for 9 Oscars. It was nominated for Best Picture, Best Director, Best Screenplay, cinematography, editing, original score, sound effects, and visual effects. In fact, I think, no, sorry. I was gonna say there's something about the visual effects category. It was a pretty new category when ET came along. There were it beat Blade Runner and Poltergeist.
Wow, that's
Yeah.
impressive.
Yeah. Which funny, very quick story about Drew Barrymore. She originally auditioned to play Carol Ann in Poltergeist, and Steven Spielberg was part of the audition process, and he was like, you're not right for Carol Ann, but I have a movie across town that I'm shooting that you'd be perfect for. And that's how she ended up in ET.
Well, she is perfect. She's adorable. She's
Yeah.
like a little tiny Drew Barrymore.
Oh,
Like,
she's
and like,
so
she,
cute.
yeah, she's so good.
Yes. All right, well, that is going to bring us now to 1993 and Jurassic Park, which, man, it's another monster movie, but a very different one. And yeah,
Yeah.
so.
All of that talk with Jaws about like, oh, they show the shark like not until the very end, just like, and this is one where you see the dinosaurs like constantly.
Yes, except for yes, absolutely. But what's interesting is I feel like that is what makes Jaws so impressive with not seeing the shark. What makes Jurassic Park so impressive is seeing the dinosaurs.
Yeah, well,
So,
and
yeah.
again, that focus on the humans. Right. So like that very now very iconic shot of Dr. Grant and like taking off his sunglasses and being like, oh my God. And then you see this vista of like dinosaurs, right? And first of all, it holds up really well still today, which is amazing. Fantastic special effects. But also it is that just that like awe that the audience gets embedded into it as well. Spielberg is really good about taking perspective and making the audience really feel the emotions of his characters. And that's what you get in that moment of just this like, oh my God, right? It's so well done.
Well, a few years ago, I don't remember which movie it was for. I'm trying to think. But I had an opportunity to interview, I think it was for one of the Planet of the Apes movies. I had the opportunity to interview Joe Letteri, who is a very well-known visual effects artist and visual effects supervisor. He's won a few Oscars too. Well, one of the earliest films that he worked on was Jurassic Park. And we talked about it because at the time it was like around the 25th anniversary, I think, of Jurassic Park. And so we talked about it, and he said that at the time that they were making that, they hoped that the effects, the visuals, would hold up for like 10 years before they started to really degrade. And this is 25 years later, and I was just like, the dinosaurs still look real. And he said, yeah, they did not imagine that they would still last as long as they have, but technology has been able to preserve, 'cause when you transfer from film to DVD or from film to 4K or whatever, there's some compression things that happen that can kind of degrade your effects. And but because of the fact that they use so many practical effects in connection with the CG, it's that's why Jurassic Park still looks more real than any of the new movies.
Yeah, I was gonna say it looks more real than any of the Jurassic World movies I've seen. Like, I'm just like, yes, those are dinosaurs. In Jurassic World, I'm like, those are not dinosaurs, those are animated characters.
Right,
Like,
yeah. Anyway, so let's talk about Jurassic Park. It's based on the novel by Michael Crichton about a crazy billionaire who figures out a way to bring dinosaurs back to life, and he decides what he's going to do with that technology is open a big theme park off the coast of Costa Rica. Because why not?
where nothing can possibly go wrong.
So why don't you talk a little bit about Jurassic Park?
This is again a film where you're like, what can I say about Jurassic Park that has not already been said? It's fantastic. Like you say, the special effects hold up so well. I remember going to see this when it got re-released several years ago. It may have been the 25th anniversary or sometime around there, because I did not see it in theaters when I was a kid, because I was too young, and my parents very rightly suspected that it would terrify me. So I'm glad that I didn't see it when it came out, but I did see it, multiple times years later, and then I got to see it in the theater again when it got re-released. And again, it holds up. It's as with the other films that we talked about, it's so well structured. You get this wonderful kind of three act story structure. The way in which he uses the, like you said, the combination of CG and practical effects, and really, again, I keep on going back to perspective in this conversation, because so much of it is about getting the audience to feel the emotions of the characters, to feel the terror, to feel, but also the awe and the surprise. Those moments where they've just been chased by a T-Rex and all of that, and then the kids and Dr. Grant, I think, they fall asleep in a tree, right? And they see this, the gentle giants, right? And it's gorgeous. And it's like that combination of like, they're not evil, right? These are animals. And they're animals that should not be alive right now. And but they're acting in the way that animals do. And so the only ones who are really treated as being like evil almost are the raptors. But even the raptors are behaving as the raptors should. And I love some of those lines that get in there, just like, you bred raptors. It's just like, oh no, they bred raptors. This must be a bad thing.
Yeah.
And yeah, getting that sensation of these animals being animals and behaving in the way that animals do, but also posing a very real threat to the people that are around them, and then also just being an incredibly stupid thing to do to bring dinosaurs back to life, and to not really think about what impact that could possibly have in a theme park setting. But also being incredibly believable. Like, I absolutely believe that someone like Elon Musk would try to bring dinosaurs back to life and then be shocked when they ate everybody.
Right. Yeah. Well, and that's the thing. And this is something that the movie talks about over and over again, especially, there's a couple of specific scenes, one around like a lunch table, and they talk about this specifically. You think you can control this, but these are wild animals. These they don't care when they are. They just know that they are, and they have a very specific, things that they need. They have their needs. And they're we, dinosaurs and humans just can't exist at the same time. There's a reason that we don't, and you can't just throw them all into what's the line? You've suddenly thrown them all back into the mix together. How can you possibly have the slightest idea what to expect? It's so true. And they, by this point, they've also already had some experiences where they've seen how dangerous this is. They're just trying to keep it quiet. So, like, you had that worker get killed, and on the tour, there's the line about the Dilophosaurus. They're like, we now know that they excrete this poisonous substance. Like, how did you learn that? What happened?
I mean, that's the thing. You're like, and it plays so well. The book does this as well, but it plays so well with those things of like, we don't know that much about dinosaurs. Everything that is known about dinosaurs is being drawn out through the fossil record and assumptions made about them. Like, we now know that they probably were covered in feathers,
Right. Yeah.
that they didn't look like the dinosaurs in Jurassic Park, right? But it is that, like, these are animals that don't exist anymore. And the film addresses that really well because it's like, okay, they're animals that don't exist anymore, which means that they have behavior that we don't necessarily understand. But they understand it because they're animals
Yeah.
and they're going to do what comes naturally to them. So creating a bunch of herbivores, it's like, okay, yeah, that kind of, I mean, but also they might step on you, but also you don't know what they are. You don't know what they're going to become because, the famous line, life will find a way.
Yeah, exactly.
And that lack of respect, I think that it's mentioned a couple times in the film, actually, the lack of respect for the animals themselves in bringing them back to life and sticking them in a theme park, is one of the things that ultimately, dooms all of them or dooms the whole thing, is that you're not respecting the life that you've created, including the fact that you shouldn't have tried to recreate it in the first place.
Right. Yeah. Well, that lunch scene when they're talking about they've kind of seen some of it. They haven't gone on the tour yet, but they've seen some of the park already, and they're having this exact philosophical discussion. And I think it's Malcolm, Jeff Goldblum, who makes the comment about not having that respect. But this is also you have Grant and Sattler who are also saying their piece. And as scientists, and in the case of Grant specifically, he's a paleontologist. Like, this is his absolute dream scenario, you would think, but he also understands that this is bad. This you can't just bring dinosaurs back. And so all three of them are saying that as scientists, as experts, they're decrying this the project, I guess. And then you have that line where then Hammond says, the only you three were brought down here to defend me, and the only one on my side is the blood-sucking lawyer. And it's a funny line, and it's delivered funny, but it's also it really does make that point about this divide between money and wealth, because the lawyer at this point is like, oh my gosh, we're gonna make so much money. And the scientists who are trying to still be respectful of of the natural world, and they're not driven by money. They need money to continue to do their work, but they're not driven by it. That's not why they get into the fields that they're into. And really seeing that divide between the two, and obviously one side's going to win out in that kind of a
Yeah.
scenario.
It's kind of like a pre-Jaws scenario of just like we can see what is coming, right? We can see that how this could possibly go wrong. And maybe this was a bad idea to begin with. And it is that like, you know, you're going to open this park to the public. It's just like what happens when there's a power outage? What happens when the fences don't work anymore? Well, we see what happens when the fences stop working. Let's talk, because one of the things that you mentioned on our Slack was the some of the changes that got made, particularly to the children characters. And it's been a long time since I read the book, but what you were saying was that they actually flipped the ages of the kids.
They did, yeah. In the book, Tim, who in the movie is played by Joseph Mazzello, he's the older brother, and I think he's like around 10 or 11. And Lex is the little sister, and she's, I think, 6. So not only did they flip the ages, but they're also they aged them up just a tiny bit as well. And because in the movie, Lex is a teenager, and or like maybe 12, 13, and then Tim is probably like 9 or 10. So they're aged up a little bit, but also flipping them was an interesting choice too, because then there's two things that I find interesting about Jurassic Park with regards to female characters. And this is something else that we talked about. I'll let you talk about Goldblum, but Laura Dern as Dr. Sattler, she's not there just to be, sexy running through the jungle, barely, with her shirt falling off or whatever. She gets to be this badass hero. And then in the end, like at the final moments when the raptors are closing in on them and they just need to still get the park back online, Lex gets to be the one who she's a computer expert. She's a computer nerd. Tim calls her a hacker and stuff and teases her about it. But she gets to be the one who ultimately saves the day because she knows what to do, because she knows how to work the system. She's able to get the power back online, which is how not only are they able to escape from the raptors in that moment, but also get the phones back on so they can call and get the helicopters and all that. So Lex, the girl, gets to save the day. And I love that.
Yeah, it's fantastic. And it's something that, you know, doesn't happen in a lot of films, but it's very subtle in a lot of ways. Like it's not emphasized particularly throughout the film. In fact, until you pointed it out, I was like, huh, that's true. I didn't really think about it like that. But it's true. It's just like, of course, yeah, this makes perfect sense.
And
It
that is
wouldn't
a
make
oh, sorry.
I was gonna say it wouldn't make any sense if the little boy was the hacker because he's a child. Yeah, sorry, go on.
Well, I was just gonna say, I mean, I think that that is how you do like how you portray characters well, like how you do it. Because you make it seamless. It just makes sense. There were mentions early on of Lex being a hacker and Lex being good at computers. So when it comes down to it and she's facing this Linux system, she knows exactly what to do. And there's doesn't need to be an emphasis on, oh, we're letting the girl be the hero. It's just it just is. And that's I think so many people, so many films and filmmakers, they try to do this performative thing where they make such a point of like, oh, look, we're letting the girls be cool, and you don't need to do that. You just need to let them be. You don't need to point it out. Do you want to talk about
Let's
Goldblum?
talk about Goldblum really quickly before like we wrap things up, because I think this is a good place to end. Speaking of gender swapping. I mean, I think that it's the cheesecake shot of Jeff Goldblum in Jurassic Park is fucking famous. Like, more memes have been made out of that shot. But it is, first of all, Spielberg understood. He understood his audience. He knew what the audience wanted. He knew what the audience needed. And what we needed was Jeff Goldblum injured with his shirt open, reclining. And just have that, just this linger on that shot for a while. Let's just stay there for a bit. Let's just do that. And I do like the fact that it is one of those things that would, in a lot of films, be absolute, that would be Laura Dern, right? It would be like, oh, we hurt Laura Dern, and now we have to see Laura Dern like half undressed and being tended to and all that. But instead, it's Jeff Goldblum being sexy, like, and yeah, like I definitely, maybe not the first time I saw Jurassic Park, but then after a little while, I was like, huh, I have feelings about this.
Yeah, Laura Dern gets to be the badass hero, and Jeff Goldblum gets to be the damsel in distress, sorry, with his shirt half off in the jungle.
Yep, it's wonderful. Like, and I think that props to Spielberg. Some I've sometimes said not very nice things about Spielberg, but I think he's absolutely correct in this instance. He did a great job. So thank you, Spielberg, for understanding your audience.
Yes. Last thing I'm going to point out about Jurassic Park before we wrap it up is that this movie was nominated for and won three Academy Awards: sound effects, editing, and visual effects. And it might have gotten in some other areas if not for another little film that Spielberg did the same year, which was Schindler's List. And I just
Wow.
sometimes I marvel, right? Like it's incredible for a director to do two big movies in one year, but he did Schindler's List and Jurassic Park at the same time. And those are both incredible films for very different reasons. One of which I've watched many, many times, and the other I've only watched once because I can't watch it again. But
Yep.
yeah. Anyway, I find
Wow.
that astounding that he did both of those the same year. So,
That is, yeah, I didn't realize they were the same year. That's remarkable.
yeah. All right. Any final thoughts about Spielberg before we close it out?
I mean, he is a fantastic filmmaker. I've said before that I think his work has fallen off. And maybe we'll talk a little bit about this next week since we are kind of running over time a little bit. But I do think his work has fallen off, and in part, I think because he's not addressing his own mystique almost. It's like he doesn't quite want to look at some of the films that he's made early on and to really like deal with the effect that he has had on American culture, on cinematic culture, and to kind of consider the reality of that a little bit more. And that's something that it's disappointing in some ways that I want to like Spielberg films, and I haven't really liked most of his films in the past like 15 years or so, which is quite a long time for a filmmaker for me to kind of just no longer hit it right. And he's so good when he's on, he is so good, as we've talked about. But I feel like he just doesn't care anymore to some degree. He hasn't been able to access that really just good, solid filmmaking.
Yeah, I hear you, and I don't disagree with you. I do think though that it's not that he doesn't care. I think he does still care, but I think that he has gotten some of the wrong message from some of his praise, especially from the praise he got early on. And I think that he just hasn't figured out how to translate that into his later films. And I don't know what the
Yeah.
answer is. I don't know if he should have stopped making movies a few years ago, if he's kind of done, or if he just has been searching for that whatever it is, and just can't find it. I don't know. But he does have some movies this century that have been great. Like Minority Report is freaking fantastic. That is one of his best films. And I would even say War of the Worlds is very underrated. Munich is incredible, also really fantastic. Both of those are from 2005. And I think The Post is a good movie too. I think that's his last good movie. I know a lot of people loved West Side Story and The Fablemans, but I have mixed feelings about both of those. But
I couldn't finish West Side Story, so that's what that like I got about half an hour, 45 minutes in, and I was just like, I don't like this. Like, this is not good. It is very seldom that I will just turn off a film, and I think that is actually the last film that I completely turned off and just did not finish.
I understand. But yeah, but his run from the early 70s, Duel was 1971, all the way till like 2005, I would say. He has a couple in there that are not so great or not as great, but pretty consistent. Like so many of his movies in that range are just phenomenal. Close Encounters, we didn't really talk about. Raiders of the Lost Ark. The Color Purple is a fantastic film. Empire of the Sun is great. Hook is so much fun. You know, Saving Private Ryan would have been a best picture if not for certain people interfering in Oscar campaigns. anyway, yeah, so I mean, he's a fantastic director. Definitely, definitely one of my he was very foundational for me growing up and a big part of the reason why I love movies the way that I do. So, yeah. All right. Well, I think that's going to wrap it up then. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, thank you all so much for listening. We especially want to thank our patrons for supporting the show and keep things going. They are Abby, Ali, Brian, Connor, Estefania, Heather, James, Judy, Carriotta, Matt, Michelle, Monty, Nanina, Robert, Steve, Sharon, and Tao. And if you would like to become a patron too and join them, you can go to patreon.com/citizendame and sign up. You can also support the show a couple of other ways. We have our Etsy shop, etsy.com/shop/citizendamepod, and Ko-Fi, ko-fi.com/citizendame. And you can connect with us other ways too. Be sure to check out our website. We have some fun pieces there and some more coming. That is citizendamepod.com. You can email us if you'd like, citizendamepod@gmail.com. And we are on all the socials, some of the socials. Particularly Instagram and Letterboxd. We still technically are on Twitter. You can find us Twitter and Instagram at Citizen Dame Pod. And then we are Letterboxd HQ at Citizen Dame. You can also find us individually. Lauren, where are you?
I am on Instagram and Letterboxd at LH Business.
And I am at Karen M. Peterson. And that is it for this week. Thank you so much for listening. We will catch you next time.
Bye.
Slow ahead. I can go slow ahead. Come on down and chump some of this shit.
You're gonna need a bigger boat.